You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning and welcome to Health 395, a special topics course that we are focusing on community health. This is our 11th broadcast of the semester. I'm Robin Sinks. I am your instructor for the course and I am glad you are here. So we have been spending a great deal of time going through the National Prevention Strategy, a federal level document that provides kind of the compass for where we are going as a country in regards to our health. Last week, we looked at the section of the document that had to do with preventing drug abuse and excessive alcohol use as a priority issue in the country. So I hope that maybe that conversation, maybe your readings, maybe what you saw on Blackboard, had you do a little bit of a self-assessment as far as your own behaviors. And in regards to this course, really encouraged you, enticed you maybe, to look at your community and how is your community set up to help prevent drug abuse, excessive alcohol use, or does your community actually support those behaviors? So I think it's just very often health courses are very much directed inward, looking at yourself, looking at the health of the individuals you may be working with. But I really want you to kind of look at your community and see what is there. How does it support health and how does it not support health? Today what we're going to look at is the priority area of injury and violence-free living. And we'll explore some of the issues there and some things that we all might do to make our communities a little bit safer. So certainly my question of the day goes back to what did you learn as a result of reading this document? Did any of it change your prior thinking? Is there something, an idea that you had about injury and violence-free living that needed to be shifted a bit? So if you care to share your comments, your questions with me, I have an 800 number. You can certainly call in. I also have an email address that you can email, and those comments will be forwarded here to me in the studio, and certainly I can respond there as well. So, as you think about this particular priority area and formulate your comments or your questions, let me just go through a very quick review again about this particular document and why we're doing what we're doing. Remember, the national prevention strategy is to increase the number of Americans who are healthy at every stage of life. So I know that several of you are also in my Health 300 class. We're going to try and focus out on all stages of life rather than just health in public education. So hopefully today you'll see some content that goes beyond what you just heard me talk about in the 300 class. When we talk about the National Prevention Strategy, we're talking about four strategic directions: healthy and safe community environments, clinical and community preventive services, empowered people, and the elimination of health disparities. All of the recommendations, all of the actions that are put forth in the document are to address one or more of those strategic directions. And then, of course, the seven priorities in the document, we're working our way through those now. We've addressed mental and emotional well-being, healthy living, healthy eating, active living, tobacco-free living, preventing drug abuse and excessive alcohol use. Today, we'll talk about injury and violence-free living, which is addressed on pages 41 through 43 in the document. And then in future broadcasts, we will be talking about reproductive and sexual health as a priority area. So again, this provides this compass for where we hope our country goes in regards to health, whether that's physical health, mental, emotional, social health, vocational health, spiritual health. So as we focus on the priority for today, injury and violence-free living, again, very broad spectrum of behaviors. Those of you in my 300 class know that I divide this content into two broadcasts. So we're going to have to try to address everything here in our short hour together. But when we're talking about reducing injury and violence, we want to remember that improves physical and emotional health. Leading causes of death from unintentional injury, or what some of us might call accidents, are motor vehicle related injuries, unintended poisoning, and falls. Witnessing or being a victim of violence is certainly an intentional injury, and it's linked to lifelong negative physical, emotional, and social consequences. So we know that the potential for injury is great, whether that injury is a result of unintentional or intentional violence. And that it can stay with us for a very long time. Let's take a look at some of the key facts that were brought out in the document that are particularly worthy of mention. And what I would like to do is start first with those key facts related to injuries. Each year, more than 29 million people suffer an injury severe enough to warrant medical attention. About 180,000 people die from those injuries. So we have a lot of folks who are injured in some way that they cannot do home care. They cannot take care of it themselves. They have to get medical care. And a significant portion of those individuals dying from their injuries. When we talk about these injuries that are seeking medical care, the number one cause of non-fatal injuries treated in emergency rooms is for falling. And that's across all age groups except the 15 to 24-year-olds. And there it's the number two cause of an emergency room visit. So falling and sustaining an injury that is significant enough to warrant medical attention is the number one and number two causes for actually going to the emergency room. On average, every day in this country, 12 working men and women are killed on the job, and more than 3 million people, including 150,000 youth ages 15 to 17, suffer a work-related injury or illness. Men, Hispanic, and foreign-born individuals have higher rates of work-related injuries. Okay, so we see some of those health disparities show up here in the work-related injury category. Motor vehicle crash-related injuries are the leading cause of death among younger people aged 5 to 34. Motor vehicle crash fatality rates are especially high in rural areas and for residents of tribal lands in part because of poor road maintenance, higher rates of alcohol-impaired driving, lower rates of seatbelt use and child safety seat use, and less access to emergency response and trauma care. So again, looking at another of the health disparities that, you know, we may often think living in a large urban area like Los Angeles, that we would see more of the injuries and death related to motor vehicle crashes. And while we do see a lot of them, those injuries show up disproportionately in some of those identified populations that have less access to care, greater access to alcohol, less access to safe roads. Nearly one-third of all crash-related deaths involve an alcohol-impaired driver. So certainly our link to last week's conversation is significant. Every day in the U.S., more than 9 individuals are killed, and more than 1,000 individuals are injured in crashes involving a distracted driver. So there are really 3 ways that you can be distracted. One is a visual distraction. You're taking your eyes off the road, whether that's to pick up something that fell in your car or to spend too much time looking at one of the billboards on the freeway or the car next to you. Visually taking your eyes off the road obviously improves your chance of being involved in a distracted driving incident. Manually, when you take your hands off that wheel, certainly response time is going to be impacted getting back up to that wheel. So again, don't reach for something that you don't have easy access to. Don't be playing with things in your hands. They should be on the wheel. And then the other way that we become distracted is cognitively. Our brain basically is taken off task. Instead of thinking about driving, we are thinking about dialing that cell phone, what we're going to get at the grocery store when we get there, adjusting the radio or the navigation system in your car. So certainly, distracted driving can include many things. Oftentimes right now, we're thinking of cell phone use, but I want you to think about distracted driving in a more global manner. Okay, so those are just a few of the key facts around injuries. Here's a few key facts taken from the document about violence. A history of exposure to adverse experiences in childhood, which includes exposure to violence and maltreatment, is associated with health risk behaviors such as smoking, alcohol and drug use, risky sexual behavior, as well as health problems like obesity, diabetes, heart disease, and attempted suicide. So exposure to those experiences in childhood may stay with us a very long time. Each year, about a third of adults aged 65 and older experience a fall. About a third, 20 to 30% of them suffer moderate to severe injury. And those falls may be violence. It may be just slipping and falling on tile on stairs because they're walking without assistance of a balance provider. We also know that homicide rates are 8 times higher among African Americans than white Americans. Homicide is actually the leading cause of death for African American youth aged 10 to 24. So again, it really shows that disparity in special populations. Okay, so lots of facts. We know that injuries are real. that violence is real. So what are some of the recommendations put forth in the document to deal with that in our country? We certainly know that injury and violence can be prevented by making our homes safer, our communities safer, our schools safer, even work sites. We can certainly strengthen, implement, and enforce policies and programs within our communities, and really focusing efforts on those groups at highest risk for some of these injuries and violent behaviors, which includes really looking at youth and older adults. So here are the recommendations set forth by the National Prevention Council. The first one being to implement and strengthen policies and programs to enhance transportation safety. So we certainly know that when those policies and programs are in place and effective, they can prevent those vehicle-related injuries and death. So we are talking about policies and programs around seatbelt use, child car safety restraints, booster seats, graduated driver's license systems. So there are restrictions on you as you get your driver's license. Policies that reduce driving while under the influence of alcohol or drugs. Distracted driving policies, laws like the cell phone use. We know that motorcycle and bicycle helmet laws have prevented many injuries and deaths. Pedestrian safety education programs are critical here. Because pedestrians have no safety gear around them as they walk down the sidewalk, cross the street, etc. So lots of things that we have in place, certainly much more that we can do as far as enhancing those, enforcing those laws, and really enhancing public education efforts. Here's an example of one such effort, a video clip called Embrace Life. Kind of a unique public service announcement encouraging the use of seatbelts. And I think that's what this particular recommendation is addressing. You know, we all know the do's and don'ts, but do we actually follow them? That was a different way to look at seatbelt safety. Okay, another recommendation that was put forth was to support community and streetscape design that promotes safety and prevents injuries. So we're talking about designing communities, designing streets that reduce those injuries, that are promoting pedestrian, bicycle, and vehicle occupant safety. So we're talking about things like modifying our roadways, separating the traffic some way from pedestrians and bicycles, instituting speed bumps to reduce the speeds. We're talking about putting in roundabouts or traffic circles or islands where pedestrians can stand outside, away from the flow of traffic. Certainly, again, this addresses the emphasis on increasing physical activity by walking and riding your bike rather than always being in a vehicle. But in doing so, we have to do so safely. So really looking at what can we do at a community and design level to address those issues. Okay, let's look at a different issue. We talked about the injuries related to falls or falling. We certainly see a recommendation to promote and strengthen policies and programs to prevent those falls, especially among older adults. So really what we're talking about here are exercise programs to increase strength and balance, medication review policies and procedures to eliminate all but the necessary drugs because they may have an impact on an individual's balance. Looking at modifications within the home, grab bars in the tub and shower, handrails at steps, and encouraging more frequent vision screening among the elderly so that we know that that's not the issue for their falling. So again, these have to do with looking at some of those clinical services. I mean, when we're having physicians review medications, asking their clients, do you have grab bars in your bathtub or shower? You know, how do you get up the steps in your home? Let's make sure we get a vision test while you're here. Those kinds of additions are actually strengthening our efforts at preventing falls. We certainly know at a community level, we want to maintain playgrounds in a safe manner, making sure that you know, when equipment is put in so that individuals take advantage of the parks, that equipment is maintained and checked frequently to ensure its safety. And we also want to work with community-based programs that are providing athletic opportunities for our kids. You know, using protective gear when kids are playing active sports, and you know, making sure there's adult supervision so that you know, when injury occurs, we can take care of it quickly without it causing further damage. But really what I'm drawn to is this focus on preventing falls in amongst the elderly, because certainly they're spending a lot of time going to the emergency departments and in rehab for the injuries they incur. And the injuries may be more severe for those same falls as you get older because of our bone structure, our diminishing muscle mass, etc. Let's take a look at a quick video clip on preventing falls in the elderly.
Accidents, but more and more they're being looked at as preventable.
There are many reasons why people fall. You know, as you get older, you get cataracts, your vision is not the same. You know, some people develop neurologic problems, so there are lots of reasons why people fall.
Falls have significant health impacts. Nationwide, they're the leading cause of injury death in those 65 and older, and 30% of those who survive a fall will suffer an injury or broken bone, which can lead to further issues.
If you fall down and you break a hip, the chances of ending up in a nursing home are about 50%.
Dr. Sal Lacagnina works in preventative medicine. He finds you can lessen your fall risk by first assessing your home, putting grab bars where needed, and looking for hazards.
Even things that occur in the home. People have throw rugs on the floor that are slippery on the bottom, and they may just trip and fall because of that.
Getting your vision check and meeting with your doctor to review medications is another good measure. One of the best protections is to increase your strength and balance.
I want you to stand up from this chair 5 times without using your hands.
Lee Memorial Health System offers balance screenings and therapy.
We also work on what we call balance strategies, which helps you if you do start to lose your balance. There's subconscious strategies that you use to help recover your balance before you actually hit the floor.
Taking a balanced approach may keep you upright and healthy. For Lee Memorial Health System, I'm Amy Osher.
That's okay. Keep going. There you go.
Hey, just some things to think about. And again, whether you're thinking about your own home or the home of family members or friends who are elderly, just have a little bit greater awareness of some of those issues. Another recommendation that was put forth by the council was to promote and enhance policies and programs to increase safety and prevent injury in the workplace. There's a lot of conversation on safety in schools, safety in playgrounds and parks. But we need to remember that for many adults, spend a lot of hours in the workplace, and workplace injuries are very real. Workplace prevention programs must be supported by management and a commitment from the management to maintain a safe workplace. But it also relies on employee participation and follow through in aligning to those safety protocols. It includes identifying hazards in the workplace and remediating them or correcting them. Training workers in workplace safety, how to lift, how to move heavy objects, how to go up and down stairs. So many of us don't even hold the handrail, yet something as simple as that prevents many workplace injuries. And then ways to reduce workplace illness, getting down to good hand washing technique, taking appropriate breaks for hydration and food. All of those kinds of things can be built in to workplace prevention programs. And then certainly, should injury or death occur, there has to be a comprehensive review of what happens, looking at how can we protect our workers from future injuries? What kind of safety trainings do we need to initiate or enhance? How can we promote a culture of safety? Are we rushing employees through their work day so that they're cutting corners on safety issues, or are we providing that commitment? We want you to do it safely. Yes, you have so much to do, but safety comes first kind of thoughts. Really looking at how do we not only prevent these workplace injuries, but how do we keep them from happening if they do happen? Certainly, another recommendation was to strengthen in policies and programs to prevent violence. And so, you know, we're looking at deterring criminal behavior, enhancing those feelings of community safety. Certainly that has to do with regulating alcohol sales in communities, ensuring housing and economic development, supporting education initiatives. All of those show promise in reducing crime and violence. And then our last recommendation, remember those overarching recommendations, is to provide individuals and families with the knowledge, skills, and tools to make safe choices that prevent violence and injury. So again, just as you know, all of the other priority issues, taking it from that community level down to that family and individual level. So this is really trying to address education and skill building programs. So we're talking about school-based programs, about preventing violence. So everything from bullying prevention, teen dating violence prevention, et cetera, to reducing unintentional injuries that happen at school, having them wear helmets if they're going to ride their bikes to school. We're also talking about prevention programs that are looking at intimate partner violence, teaching students how to develop social skills so that they can handle conflict without resorting to violence, parent education with positive family interactions, really looking at youth development programs. All of those are kind of things that focus on youth and families, and the school tends to be the center of it. But also remember that our community-based organizations and our faith-based organizations have a significant role to play there. We're also looking at that individual and family level where, you know, again, workplace interventions that we as individuals know how to prevent those injuries. We know the policies, the programs, the procedures. We take advantage of safety training. And if something happens or we see a potential for injury, we're reporting it. So those are kind of the broad-based recommendations from the council. And really those are set forth in hopes that, yes, they would actually make a difference. So how do we make a difference? We look at some of those key indicators. And we track over time, those key indicators. Do we see a decrease in the rate of fatalities due to alcohol-impaired driving? We have lots of statistics, and are we seeing that there are fewer incidents of alcohol-related driving that cause a fatality? Do we see a decreased rate in homicides in our communities? Do we see a decrease in the rate of motor vehicle crash-related deaths? So when we look at those key indicators and we track them over time, that helps us to identify, is what we have planned out actually making a difference? Is it effective? Or are we seeing a spike? Are we seeing an increase instead of a decrease? And what might we attribute that to? So always looking at that data to make sure we are on target with our goals for the National Prevention Strategy, as well as those recommendations that are based on a lot of research expressed through a lot of those key documents. All right, so we've talked about these recommendations. What should we do? All right, so let's break that down into what can we do, depending on where we are in this community, and what should we do? Can and should are can be very different. But certainly, we need to have the cans first. What can we do? Well, the government, let's take a look at governmental actions. The government can strengthen and enforce transportation safety policies and programs. Those are things that we all must follow. That's the institution of laws. And certainly the government is responsible for that. Government can implement traffic engineering strategies that which allow pedestrians, bicycles, and motorists all to safely use that space to move across the community. And certainly that's implemented at a community level, but government has the ability to set up those standards. Government can implement countermeasures for impaired driving, and those are those sobriety checkpoints that I'm sure we've all been through at some point. Rather than waiting for the accident to happen, checking folks and pulling those off the road who are under the influence of alcohol or other drugs. Enforcing speeding and safety regulations is another way that we can enhance that traffic safety. We certainly want to implement the drug impairment laws. So a lot of this is implementing many of the laws that we already have in place. And really, you know, this is about the drug screening. From driving vehicles to showing up at work. And then the government can also develop systems to set up or to increase access to trauma care. Where are those trauma care centers in our community? Not every emergency department is designated for trauma care. It's a very high level of care for those very severe injuries. So how do we develop systems to better access those care institutions when we need them? So certainly the government has a role in all of this, but let's bring it down closer to our community. What can businesses and employers do? Well, certainly we've talked a lot about workplace, so we know that they have a role, but not just about the workplace. It can go beyond. Businesses and employers can implement and enforce safety policy for drivers. Now, making sure seat belts or restraint systems are used, zero tolerance for distracted driving. Many businesses require their employees to drive as part of that business, and certainly they have control over that. But even in those messages that businesses and employers send out about the hazards of driving under the influence of driving while distracted, certainly those can carry over beyond workplace. Certainly businesses and employers can implement workplace injury prevention programs, and not only implement them, but evaluate them and you know, see if the data supports what we're doing in those programs. Are we seeing a decrease in workplace injuries? Are we seeing an increase in the use of safety procedures? So businesses have a role there to play. Healthcare systems, insurers, and clinicians certainly have a role to play in this priority. We've already talked a little bit about the impact of falling, of those fall-related injuries. So clinicians certainly can be conducting fall risk assessments, particularly for those older adults, reviewing medications that an individual is on and modifying those to only those necessary medications. We certainly know that medications interact with each other, and when individuals are taking lots of medication, that may have an impact on our safety. Certainly vision screenings need to be done. I know in the past many clinicians just, you know, didn't even talk about vision screening. Then we got to the point where they were asking individuals, have you had your yearly eye checkup? How's your vision doing? Are you wearing your glasses? To now, you know, many of them doing vision screenings in their offices, having a close relationship with another provider in their building, so that you can kind of do the one-stop shopping. So certainly clinicians have a place to in all of this. They also need to know about what each of their clients does in a work-related arena. Doing some occupational risk assessments, environmental risk assessments, as part of that history that they take from all of their patients. And doing some of that counseling and intervention right then and there with them. In the recommendations, it talked a lot about schools and what schools could do with youth. So let's look specifically at the actions that can be taken at early learning centers, schools, colleges, and universities. Encouraging youth to wear their seatbelts, use their bicycle helmets, not drive while distracted or under the influence of alcohol and other drugs. So you'll start to see these kinds of messages on college campuses as that visual cue, that reminder. We want you to be safe here on campus, and we want you to be safe as you come to and from campus. Schools, universities, colleges can collect and report statistics on crime and issue timely warnings to the community about things that might threaten health and safety. That notification system that most campuses now have in place, the notification system that schools have in place with family members. Those are all important in this violence and injury-free living arena. And certainly implementing policies and environmental design which reduces crime on campuses, encourages cooperative learning, making sure that the buildings and the grounds are maintained, supporting that culture of care and compassion, and quenching any of the messages of violence. Those are all a place that early learning centers, schools, colleges, and universities can take part in. Communities, nonprofits, and faith-based organizations also have a role to play in all of this. Promoting safer and more connected communities that prevent injury and violence. So really looking at communities and fostering economic development, fostering those safer environments, building public awareness campaigns around some of these major issues. So preventing falls, wearing seat belts, conflict resolution, getting help, reporting crime when you see it. Those are all things that can be done at a community level. And then looking at our community and providing support systems for individuals who are reintegrating into our communities. They may be juveniles or adults who have been incarcerated. They're returning to school, returning to their communities, helping them get employment, a safe place to live, so that they too can lead a healthy lifestyle. Oftentimes we see that reintegration kind of fall apart. So those are things that can be picked up and certainly supported by communities, nonprofits, and faith-based organizations. All right, so then now we get down to that last part where individuals and families have a role, and this is our personal responsibility. One, we can refrain from driving while under the influence of alcohol or other drugs, whether we're drowsy or distracted. So really paying attention to our own driving. Using seat belts, bicycle helmets, motorcycle helmets, protective gear. You know, that we have power over that. In our families, establishing clear expectations and consequences for those teen drivers about safe driving. You know, what do we expect around following speed and traffic laws, using your seatbelts, not being distracted while you're driving, not being under the influence. So really looking at communication within a family. And then for all of us to engage in physical activity, which increases our muscle strength and enhances our balance and coordination. We don't want to wait until we're an older adult to begin that. We want that to be a lifelong process. So certainly there is a role to play for all of us, and for many of us we have several roles to play. But there are things that we can do to really look at preventing injuries and violence. And the nice thing is that we have some great resources to draw from. So, you know, I know that all of you are looking at key documents as we go through this, and you've given me your key document reports, which I will be scoring over the weekend. But I also hope that you don't stop looking at those key documents just because your assignment is done. I certainly want to encourage you to look at the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration. The key documents were referenced here, but I also want you to look at their website. You know, typically this is not a website that many of us in health would think first about, but if you could just show my computer screen, it has a wealth of information that we can all draw from. Everything from driving safely to specifics about vehicle safety, a great reference section on laws and regulations. But I would really encourage you to look at the key issues that are identified on the website. Drunk driving, crash test ratings, distracted driving, lots of information about car seats. And I really do want you to look at that one, because car seat regulations are often changing and enhanced over time. Pedestrian safety, seatbelt issues. So lots of great resources on this particular website that can be used for ourselves, with our families, and within our community. I also want to draw your attention to the Centers for Disease Control website, which has a page on essential elements of effective workplace programs. You know, please reference that as well, whether you are an employer or an employee. Might want to take a look at this and just rate your own employer or your own business if you are the owner, and see how you might enhance your own program. And then also the CDC has great information on fall safety. So certainly lots to look at. I mean, I hope you spend lots of time looking at Centers for Disease Control. If you go to their home and recreational safety page, they've got some great stuff there. So there's a great wealth of key documents here. And remember that with the National Prevention Strategy, this is really based on what research tells us, what we know is effective, or we know has great potential for effectiveness. And you know, here in a couple of weeks, we're going to actually be looking at some of the trend data. You know, this has been around since 2011. Are things that are promoted in this document or referenced in this document, are they leading us to a healthier America. I do want to just highlight a couple of the projects that were mentioned in the document as far as examples of things that work. So the first project highlight I just want to remind all of you to just take a look at is the Teen and Adult Driver Responsibility Act that was instituted in the state of Georgia. This is a graduated driver licensing act, and many states have that. You don't turn 16 and have full access to driving and the roads. But in Georgia, what they did was they actually implemented this graduated driving protocol. So it looked at all of the additional restrictions on young drivers and at what point do we take off some of the restrictions so that at what point can a new driver, a teen, actually have full driving privileges. But it also included automatic license revocation for excessive speeding, not just alcohol use, but excessive speeding. But the thing about this particular project and why it's highlighted here is because of the results that it saw. They actually evaluated it over time and saw that the number of fatal crashes among drivers subject to the law had dropped by 38%. These drivers were also less likely to be convicted of speeding or driving under the influence of alcohol. So it really showed how this graduated driving program policy, in Georgia they called it an act, really did make a difference as far as health and safety of those new drivers. And many states now have this, and many states are really looking at the effects of it and is it working? And you know, that's where we always are getting you know, those questions about, well, if all of these accidents are happening with young drivers, do we up the age of driving? Do we put more restrictions? Do we put additional training and supervised driving into that? And those are good conversations for every community to have because it means that they're actually looking at the data and deciding, you know, what else can we do to protect our young teen drivers. The other project highlight that I just want to mention to all of you are the Urban Networks to Increase Thriving Youth. The acronym is UNITY. And I want to show you the Prevention Institute's website, if I can. There's the address for you. But this particular website is really looking at promoting sustainable efforts to prevent violence before it occurs in cities and communities where they're really emphasizing collaborative approaches and having folks in the Justice Department have conversations with those in education, social service, public health, and youth-serving organizations. So here tells a little bit about the Institute, and really it's a convener of, you know, what we know and can do. But looking at some of the tools, that how do we collaborate across a community? The areas that they are really focusing on is preventing injury and reducing, preventing violence and reducing injury. They are also looking at reforming health systems, supporting healthy food and active environments, health and health equity, promoting mental health and well-being. So I really wanted you to see this site because it links to some of the other priority issues that we have addressed here. You'll see on their very front page, they are highlighting what's going on in California. So since we're in California, you might want to take a particular look at that. Prevention is primary, is really looking at community well-being. So for those of us who are involved in public health, in community health, in health promotion efforts, whether those are in schools or in practices across the community, this is background information that is good for all of us to have, but because we can't hold it all in our heads, take down, keep some of these reference sites for you in your work so that you can draw from that. And certainly, we are at the point in the semester where you have two remaining assignments due. April 13th, you have your website review. That is a very significant assignment where you are reviewing a governmental and a non-governmental website for each of the 7 priority areas. So I hope you've already begun that. That's a big one. April 13th, you also have a discussion board that is due. And very shortly after that, you have your lesson plan. So you've now been introduced to 6 of the 7 priorities. I hope you're picking something that's of interest to you in your community that you will be able to possibly implement in the future and do something to promote the health of other individuals, your family members, or your community, your neighborhood. So just kind of a reminder of things to come. Specifically, next week, April 4th, there is no broadcast. That is the end of spring break. So you have next Saturday morning off. But don't forget that you've got just a few weeks right after that. This is session 11. We only have 3 more broadcasts and we are finished with our semester. So do something fun, relaxing for yourself over spring break. Manage your time well. That's a healthy trait. And we will see you back here on April 11th, same time, same place, where we will be addressing the 7th priority area for sexual and reproductive health. So until then, here's wishing you health, peace, and happiness. Take care.